You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download. And here we are back in our shot. So let's take a little look at the small timing changes I've made in the little break. And you can see here, we've got a bit more of a staccato sort of infection happening, which I kind of like. And the way that I did that, just so everyone's on the same page, is I came in and I added a few more little keyframes on the timeline. And all of those keyframes, I changed to ease in, ease out by just having them selected and changing their interpolation there to ease in, ease out. And that's what helps give me that slightly less linear looking animation. The point that we've got to now in this shot is to try to blend this together a little bit better. And we're going to do this with a couple of different things. The first thing is going to be the color. The second thing is going to be matching in some of the blurring. And the final thing that we're going to do in this part is to finally blend that shape together a little bit more so we don't have those hard edges anymore. Okay, but first things first, let's look at color correction. And I'll come into my nodes here and we can go to color. And I'm doing this because I want to show you the different color correction options that we have available to us. But I'm just going to start with a color correct. I'm just going to bring that in there. Obviously looking at the math composite output as well, just so we can see what's happening downstream. Now, the color correction node actually brings us in another graphic element, or another UI element, which is the color wheels. So we can just come in and be spinning our color wheels just a little bit, which is probably the easiest way of doing things. So what I'm trying to do is just match the colors a little bit more as they come through and get warped by the math composite with that hard light. I'm just trying to saturate them a little bit more so we're back to the original wall colors. So that helps sell our effect a little bit better. If we're done with the color wheels, we can also come down into the node parameters themselves and just sort of bump the saturation up possibly. Yeah, I kind of like that. With color correct, we have things for master, shadows, midtones, and highlights. So it's the same basic controls, but we can isolate one or the other. So with the shadows, I might just bump those up a little bit. Yeah, that's starting to look quite nice. Highlights. Maybe change the contrast on the highlights. That's actually looking kind of nice now. I think with that though, I do need to come back into my master and take the saturation down again. We're sort of oversaturating now. Yeah, that's good. So we've got the infection happening and then, yeah, just it's taking on the colors from the wall. Yeah, I'm liking that. I think that works nicely. Okay, the other thing that we've got as we play this through, though, is we do have a little bit of dodgy rack focus. So at some points in this frame, 8209, we've got a very sharp insert, but the background is starting to blur out a little bit. Whether that's just losing focus slightly or motion blur or a combination of the two, it helps to make this insert stand out a little bit too much. So let's change that up. I'm going to add a bit of a blur here. And I'm going to add the blur really quite high up in the stream. So probably between the hold and the transform, we'll just bring the blur in there. Now we do have quite a few blurs. Let's actually do the search and just type in blur. You can see we have quite a few blurs happening now, including lots of sapphire blurs. So anything that says S underscore is a sapphire effect. A directional blur might be quite nice if we've got motion blur, but let's see if we can get away with just like a regular straightforward blur. I'm going to take my blur to Gaussian here and take the value down to zero. Again, let's preview that math composite. And let's find the frame where everything should be sharp, the last frame where everything should be sharp. And that actually probably is here. Just blur, add a keyframe on the blur there. Come out to where things are a little bit blurry. It's around about here. Add a couple of points of blur, maybe not four. Two should be all right there. Let's come through, see if, yeah, we do have, I mean, the motion blur is a little bit tricky. Let's see if we can, see if we can fake it. And we're going to come back into focus in a second. Almost focus. Let's add another keyframe there. Set that to one. Blurring out again here. Back up to four on that. Maybe 4.2 here. Before coming back sharp at this point. So let's take that down to zero again. Yeah. Do we have another? Yeah, we've got another round of blurring again. Okay, so that's sharp. Come into the timeline. Let's add another keyframe. Right click, add keyframe. Move this along. Let's bring that back down to zero again. Nice and sharp towards the end. Now, the reason we can't do this automatically with motion blur, even though we've tracked in the motion, we've got really nice motion happening. The majority of our movement is being done by the power mesh warp, and the power mesh warp doesn't support motion blur. So that's why we're doing it this way instead. If we were doing like a regular transform match move, then we wouldn't have any problems. We could just turn on motion blur and have all of this set up for us. And that's starting to fit in really nicely now. Okay, the only thing, I think the big thing that's holding us back is something that we've talked about probably since exercise two, I think, and that's some of the sharp edges that we have with our roto. If I come back into the roto controls here, on the node itself, I've even turned off motion blur, so we've got actually no motion blur happening on the roto itself. We can turn that back on. It might make a little bit of a difference, but probably not too much. Because what I actually want to do here is I want to add in a bit of softness, bit of blurring to the roto itself. Now, we could do that. I think we saw this earlier. We could do that directly in the parameters and sort of do a big blur over everything. But I don't want to do it this way. This is not the right way to do it here. Because if we take a look in the object list, we can break down this blur either by shape or by layer. And I think layer is the way to go with this. I'm going to start from the top. We've got our fingers sub roto. So that's this area here. It's where it's pretty egregious here. Zoom in and let's blur that up. And the nice thing about, let's turn that on there. And the nice thing about having the blur on either the shape or the layer is that we can choose what type of blur we do. We can either have this centered, we can have an inner blur, so it's just eating inwards, or outer blur, so it keeps the edges, the sharp edges we've got, and just expands that outwards. Let's look at that over the RGB. So centered, going both directions, inner and outer. And I think inner is probably the right way to go for the fingers here. Because of the way we rotoed up to the shadow here. Okay, let's take a little look at the rest of the hand. Let's close up my finger sub roto and let's go to the arm. Now I think we need like a different type of softness for the forearm than for the fingers. Zoom out a little bit here so we've got a bit more context. So let's select everything. But I'm going to control or command select the forearm so we're not affecting that anymore. Let's just unlock everything there. And I'll unlock my arm roto so that we can now come in. Again, control or command select that forearm so we're not selecting that. And then I can come in and we can just blur this as well. Let's see a blur Blur inner doesn't do exactly what I want it to do. Blur outer is a little bit too far. So let's just go with the blur centered and keep that blur amount kind of low-ish. 5 or 6 points. I think that should be fine. Yeah, that's fitting in quite nicely. All right. So now the only thing we need to look for is this forearm roto, the forearm shape, I should say. Let's come towards the end. And let's just blur that out. And I'm going to do quite a big blur on this. I'm just going to have this going inwards. And that should help to cover some of our sins up of the slightly dodgy roto we did towards the front end anyway. So let's give this another quick playback and see how we're looking. Okay, so the animation's nicer. We're not able to see some of the roto slippage anymore because we've done, you know, exactly what we planned to do right from the very start, which is give it a little bit of softness. And we've also got the sort of blur now matching much better for when the camera moves, so it's not sort of standing out as much as it was previously. Yeah, I kind of like that. We've got a nice looking effect, and we've got a better understanding of what's happening within our nodes. And this is definitely a good place to take another breather. What we're going to be looking at in the next part of this exercise is how we can just relight the scene in a simple way. We're going to be recycling some of the data that we created all the way back in exercise 3. So that's a little while ago now. All right, well, thank you for being with me so far. I'll see you again in the next section.